Hola amigos de Wine News TV, nos encontramos en el restaurante Ariel y estoy con un Master Sommelier. Los Master Sommeliers son como los Jedi. I'm saying that Master Sommeliers are like the Jedi in the wine world. So it's a privilege to be with Joseph Spellman. He works for Landmark Vineyards. We have two wines with us. We have a Chardonnay and a Pinot Noir. We're going to taste in front of the camera. We're going to talk about potential food wine pairings. But first, you know, not often do I get to sit down with a master sommelier. What is a master sommelier?
Well, a master sommelier is expected to be knowledgeable about wine, beer, spirits, sake from all around the world.
Okay.
And so I've worked with great wines from a number of great regions in a number of great restaurants. The special skills have to do with restaurant work. So managing a cellar, being attentive to tableside needs, understanding the rhythms of the kitchen and the rhythms of dining, being a good recommender of fine wine, and then handling the wine professionally for service. That means polishing glassware, moving around the room in an elegant way, decanting
it's
bottles.
It's much more than just knowing about
That's
wine.
Right. It's not just about knowledge. It's about service. It's about attitude. And it's about, I think, generally a sense of the social and cultural environment of the restaurant.
How long have you been a master sommelier for now?
Well, I passed the exam in 1996 when I was...
Is it as hard as they say it is?
I'd say it's very hard.
That's why there aren't that many of you guys.
It continues to be a slow-growing organization.
Yeah.
In 1996, when I was the sommelier at Charlie Trotter's, I was the 29th American to pass the exam.
Yeah.
And now we have over 175 Americans who
are members of the court. 175 like you, members of the court.
Right.
Wow.
So we've grown quite a bit, and some years we'll find seven or eight candidates who are very good and pass through. Others, it's only one or two.
Yeah.
And the exam does vary from year to year, and we ask a lot of different challenges.
You guys don't
questions.
Even feel a jumbo jet. I mean, it's less than the capacity. So tell us about, Joe, tell us about Landmark Vineyards.
Right. I'm very fond of the winery, of course. It's one of the very first wineries I ever visited as a young, know-nothing wine enthusiast, I suppose I'd say, in the early 1980s. It was started by... a woman named Damaris Deer Ford, who was the founding partner in terms of financial and development, along with a group of grape growers in northern Sonoma County, led by the Mabry family. The winery moved. It eventually became solely owned by Damaris and continued to develop a reputation for being one of the best Chardonnay producers in Sonoma County, always at a fairly small scale. Our company acquired Landmark Vineyards in 2011 when the family that was running it wanted to turn it over to somebody who could continue the legacy. We have since developed quite a few more vineyard contracts and sources, and we continue with a very traditional style of barrel fermented Chardonnay in the Burgundian fashion, using native yeast. No inoculated
yeast. So when
the
company you work for acquired the property and everything, you guys kept the same philosophy?
That's correct.
Okay, good to know.
Right. And so the wines are, in a way, traditional to the Burgundian, I guess, standards that were set by the original winemaking team going back 35 years.
Okay.
So it's a very, I guess, you'd say natural wine in the sense that it is pressed into barrel, fermented in the barrel, using native yeast, no additional yeasts. We allow the wine to go all the way through malolactic fermentation, and we do not permit any, well, I'm sorry, excuse me, I turned the other way around. We want the wine to be on the lees all the way through that period, and it's technical talk, I know, but these are all Burgundian practices that, again, don't permit the development of excessively buttery aromas in our Chardonnay. And that's something we are very cautious about. We want to be toasty and, you know, broad in aroma and flavor, but still a very dry and successful wine for food.
Let's get right into them. What can you tell me about this Chardonnay, the 2015? I'm a little nervous. I'm trying wine and trying to describe wine with a master sum. It's like if you want to do a sword fighting with Yoda. It's a little hard.
Hardly.
All right, cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers to that.
Well, there's no fighting here. I think
no fighting.
The pleasure of this wine, it starts with color. And because this wine's a couple of years old, 2015 was a very important vintage for us. It was the 25th anniversary of making Overlook Chardonnay. Overlook was the brand name developed for the landmark wine that incorporated multiple vineyards throughout Sonoma County, and sometimes a little help from other regions, but this is a Sonoma County Appellation wine. And the idea is that we're, again, working with some new but mostly older French barrels. We don't want barrels to be a big influence on the wine, but we wanted to express classic Chardonnay fruit, that is apple, some of that kind of pear note.
Pineapple, a little bit of
tropical. We try to avoid tropicality, but with time, it does take on a little more depth of fruit. So there could be kind of a roasted pineapple or grilled pineapple aroma come up. But for the most part,
here I get, you know, a nuttiness that I love.
There's the nut component, almond or hazelnut, roast hazelnut. Yeah. Those are really nice aromas that come about with time, with the lees, and with barrels. So those are desirable aromas that you might find in a Burgundy. And of course Chardonnay in Burgundy is
I love the fact that because, you know, I'm not gonna name names here, but certain, you know, American California Chardonnays can be overblown, way too ripe, buttery. True. Here you see this sort of prudence, this caution, this restraint. Right. I love the nose, how it, you know, everything is sort of in place.
Right. So I think we're trying to be traditional in a lot of ways. We want to have fruit that's appropriately ripe for each vineyard, and we work with over 15 different vineyards to blend this wine, but we never want to have that excessive ripeness level that would develop into that fruit cocktail aroma and flavor that was prevalent in a lot of Sonoma Chardonnays in the 80s and 90s.
I'm getting some pear. I'm loving the pear that I'm getting, and it's full. I mean, it's a rich wine,
right,
but it's not heavy. It's not... I always say that sometimes certain wines are like Shaquille O'Neal because they're too big.
Oh, no
but
doubt.
Certain wines are like Shaquille O'Neal with stilettos working, you know, on the runway.
I want that picture.
This is very good. In terms of wine food pairing, if I were to give you a call, hey, Joe, yes, I bought the landmark Overlook Chardonnay. Right. What should I prepare for dinner? What should I pair it with?
Well, first off, pop the cork before you start cooking and have a glass.
Of course.
Right? This is a chef who always cooks with wine, and sometimes it gets in the food. Anyway, the idea of a good seafood dish in the sauté pan, that's something quick to make, would be a great starter. I love working with scallops.
You took that word out of my lips. I was thinking scallops with some sort of buttery or
right,
or
so
nutty.
You heat up your butter in the pan and kind of even start like browning it a little bit, and then very hot scallop, you know, 30 seconds on each side, and you're good. And it's an amazingly good flavor with a Chardonnay that's barrel fermented like this. Other dishes that would be a little more time and require a little more preparation, I would say certain preparations of roast cod, definitely richer shellfish like lobster, scampi, various seafood stews possibly. And of course, Chardonnay was made for those kinds of flavors.
Would you pair it with a white meat like pork?
You certainly could. And again, how's the pork being prepared? If you're in a very rich
sauce. We eat a lot of
sauce,
pork in Puerto Rico. I always ask about pork.
I love
Christmas,
it.
Pork is the animal of choice. And
I'm all in. You know, vitamin P is one of the most important flavors to go with Chardonnay.
It's delicious. And you know, you and I met yesterday. We were talking off camera. And this wine is less than $35. That's unbelievable. You can get it with La Cava de Serrayes. This is a spectacular Chardonnay. At the price point, it can stand toe-to-toe with American Chardonnays that cost two or three times more.
I think so.
Let's go to the Pinot Noir. What can you tell me about this 2016 Overlook Pinot Noir?
All right. So we started making Pinot Noir in the Overlook label in 2012. So this is still a fairly young, developing concept.
I always skip that part because I'm not a sommelier.
That's all right.
Yeah, I'm a desperate
always got to look at the wine. But the Pinot Noir program has grown quite a bit for us, largely by going outside Sonoma County. So this wine has a lot of fruit from Monterey County in the Santa Lucia Highlands, which are a really great Pinot Noir growing zone. These are east-facing hills at modest elevation in Monterey, which is quite a cool growing zone, like Sonoma. There is Sonoma fruit here as well. There is Santa Barbara fruit from the Santa Rita Hills, which is a quite cool growing zone. And so we get very delicate color.
Yeah.
You know, it's a Pinot Noir you can see through.
Exactly, yeah.
You have a lot of opportunity to give it a
swirl.
And you have fresh raspberry, strawberry,
cola,
cherry.
Cola
is one of my favorite notes we get here. Sometimes a little earthiness, maybe a little black pepper.
There's a freshness to it. I don't know if it's pine or it's some kind of underbrush. There's a freshness to it that I'm really, really
taking. So I think Pinot Noir, when it's 100% Pinot Noir, which this is, it's unadulterated wine.
Very little makeup.
There's no Syrah fattening it up. There's nothing darkening it. Just a little bit of this toasted oak and a little more new oak here than we do with our Chardonnay. But Pinot Noir generally is going to require that to allow the wine to aerate over the period of less than a year before
it's
we bottle.
It's delicate, I mean, but obviously it has the gravitas of a good fruit.
Well, the key thing, the key flavor structural component with Pinot Noir is acidity.
Yeah.
Because you don't have a whole lot of tannin, it's not bitter, it's tart.
Yeah.
And that tartness
like a
really
bitter
projects
cherry kind
the flavor
of thing.
Through. Right.
A bitter cherry.
Yeah, that's quite a flavor. Some cherry liqueurs have that, where it's an unripened cherry.
And the beautiful thing about Pinot in terms of gastronomy is just because it has that sort of nice bitterness or nice amaro to it, it helps to clean the palate.
It does.
There's a little, even a little salinity, a little bit of, I don't know, saltiness at the end. It's savory. It's a savory wine.
Well, many Monterey Pinots are said to have some of that salinity character.
I'm not flunking the test, Master.
Not at all. You're doing very well. and that's a very fashionable descriptor these days, salinity or savoriness.
It's
Pinot Noir has it, especially when you've got high-quality fruit going into very high-quality barrels and then giving it a little time. So this wine's got a couple of years of
pairing for our viewers out there. I'm going to buy that Pinot. What should I prepare?
Well, I don't know how you feel about fowl, but I'm a big fan of duck breast, even confit of duck leg. And this might be even the more magical pork wine, depending on the cut. So if you're doing a nice chop with a good sauce, this is something richer that would do well with that.
And I love the fact that Pinot is so versatile because it's got tea, cranberry notes, and it's not sweet, but it's juicy. It's a beautiful. And I believe this is also under $40, right?
It is. It's actually parallel pricing to the Chardonnay, very close to $30 to $35.
These are two spectacular bottles of wine. Amigos, voy a terminar en español. I'm going to do my rap in Spanish. Vinos extraordinarios, son dos vinos que consiguen en la Cava de Serrallés, en Ponce y en San Juan. Ninguno de los dos cuesta más de $35, se podría llevar las dos botellas por 70, más el IVA un poquito más. Extraordinarios vinos californianos, fruta de gran calidad, por supuesto vinos muy gastronómicos. Agradezco a Chef Ariel por la oportunidad que nos ha dado, nuestro proyecto Wine News TV. Será hasta la próxima. Master, they call you Master sometimes, right?
Some do.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Salud. Thank you.
Salud.